funky to funky. We know how to rock your party.
This is Michael. Today he's going to hit his girlfriend so hard, she ends up with permanent brain damage.
Three dead in this vehicle. The girl is critical. They say the guy without the seatbelt did the damage.
No seatbelt, no excuse. From DOE, supported by AXA Insurance.
Okay, so fractal fractions. 5 equals 5. Bear with me now. Let's explode this 5 into fifths. 25 fifths, to be precise. Now I want to split it into two parts. Say, 17 fifths plus 8 fifths. Could have been 1 plus 24 or whatever, I don't care. Okay, now I'm ready for the fun part. Since this 5 down here is just as much a 5 as any 5 is 5, such as this whole thing, which is equivalent to 5, let's go ahead and replace that 5 with this messier looking but still very 5-ly 5. This one too. Oh, and now we've got more 5s, so we can do it again. And again, and again, and then you can give someone this whole thing and be like, whoa, it's 5! Making things look more confusing than they actually are is a delicate art, but it speaks to the true heart of algebra, which is that you can shuffle numbers around all day, and as long as you follow the rules, it all works out. Okay, here's another one. Say you want to do something with 7. Maybe you could use 7 over 7, which is 1, so you need 6 more. Why not just add it? There, 7 equals 7 over 7 plus 6. Now you could replace one or the other, but why not both? 7 equals 7 over 7 plus 6 over 7 over 7 plus 6 plus 6. Instead of writing it all again, why not just extend this way? There we go. This equals 7. And you can actually take this all the way to infinity. The 7s kind of disappear, but then again, it didn't really matter what they were in the first place as long as they're the same. All these 7s could have been 3, or a billion, or pi to the I, and this would still equal 7, as long as this numerator equals this denominator, this fraction equals 1, and whatever else you may think about algebra, at least it has the courtesy to make 1 plus 6 be 7, every time. The fractal structure of this first fraction was like a binary tree, each layer with twice as many terms as the one above it growing exponentially, and this one does too, but sideways. But awesomely enough, this is obviously an abacabadabacaba pattern. That's a fractal pattern that's actually found lots of places, but I'm not going to get into that right now. Point is, if you named this innermost layer A, and the next B, and the next C, and the next D, and then tried to read it from top to bottom, you get abacabadabacaba. And if your fraction was infinite, you'd get abacabadabacaba e abacabadabacaba fabacabadabacaba e abacabadabacaba gabacaba, and so on. Anyway, a foolish algebra teacher would teach you that algebra is about solving equations, as if the goal of life were to get X on one side and everything else on the other, as if every fiber of your being should cry out in protest when you see X on the left side and yet more X on the right side. But you could replace that X with what it equals, and then you could do it again and again, and each time your equation is still true. How's that for getting rid of the X on this side? And you can make equations even more confusing by remembering special numbers and identities. Write whatever you want. As long as you can sneak in a multiplied by zero, you don't even have to bother knowing what the rest is. Or, knowing that all you need is the top and bottom of the equation to be the same to get 1, these 6s don't need to be 6s, they could be 3s, or 8 square root 13, or you could even make each layer different. 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Now look how confusing this is. Awesome. So you wanted to actually solve one of these things. Say you started with this puzzle. What is 1 over 1 plus 1, but each 1 is over 1 plus 1, and so on, all the way to infinity. You could try doing it by hand, thinking maybe it'll converge on something. 1 over 1 plus 1 is 1 half. So the next layer, these are a half, add up to 1, so this is 1 over 1, 1. Three layers back to 1 half. Uh-oh, any whole number of layers is gonna give either 1 or a half. So what could this possibly be? Well, you could try doing algebra to it. Say all this equals x. Look, you've isolated x on one side and everything else on the other, and it doesn't help one bit. Take that, math teacher. Okay, but if all this is x, then all this, which is the same as all this, is x. You can write this as 1 over x plus x, which completely works. You could generate it all again by replacing x with 1 over x plus x. And now that you've got those helpful x's on the wrong side of the equation, you could solve it and get the boring way to write this number if you wanted. One last fraction, this one with a caution sign. Say you want something to equal 1. Split 1 into a half plus a half. Now, these 1s could be replaced with a half plus a half. Each time you do this, it works. What happens if you go to infinity? It's weird because if you look at any number of layers of 2s to see if it converges to something, the result is always 2 for each fraction, which might make you think that at infinity it's also 2 for each fraction, and therefore 1 equals 4? And just looking at this and trying to take it backwards, you might say all this equals x, and all this equals x, so it's x plus x over 2. Just try and solve that equation. The problem is, half of something plus half of something always equals that something, no matter what the x. So this could be anything, it's undefined. Or, say you want to make something with all 1s, like this. Now x equals x plus x over 1, or x equals x plus x. You can algebra your way to a contradiction, and as far as algebra is concerned, this is undefined. Or you could think, well, there's two numbers I know that fit this description, infinity and 0. This, I suppose, could be either, or both at once, or nothing at all, I don't know. Why does it do that? Maybe because the numerator got lost up there and could have been anything. Interesting, though, that even here, when the denominator got lost in infinity, you can still solve this back to 5. That's, to me, the cool part about algebra. Unlike the neat little problems they put in grade school textbooks, not all problems can be solved, and it's not always obvious when there's an answer and when there's not. Weird stuff happens all the time. And most importantly, algebra isn't a dead ancient thing. There are things no one's ever done before that you can do with the simplest concepts. As simple as that x is what x is.
What could your change be? Coinstar. Cash in, go splurge.
Credit score.
Stop, oh my.
Some good credit.
Always got the
credit card.
Don't change our channel.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to our 13th day of continuous coverage of Joe Pilato's ever-changing credit score. I'm Skip Rogers, and I'm here today with Roger Agastu.
Well, thank you, Skip. Now, last time we checked in with Joe, he had a credit score 610. Good. Not great. And he was about to buy a big ticket purchase on his credit card, a plasma screen TV. Let's go to the field.
Bring it up right now, Roger. All right, he pulls the card out of his pocket.
Now look at his face. This man knows what he wants. He wants a plasma screen TV.
And he swipes it. And the card is
no good.
Declined.
Oh, that is a bummer.
Well, I think he'll be on the disabled bench for a few days until he can heal up his credit score.
Absolutely. Now, we've got to go, but after a word from our sponsor...
Hello, ladies. Look at your man. Now back to me. Now back at your man. Now back to me. Sadly, he isn't me. But if he stopped using lady-scented body wash and switched to Old Spice, he could smell like he's me. Look down. Back up. Where are you? You're on a boat with the man your man could smell like. What's in your hand? Back at me. I have it. It's an oyster with two tickets to that thing you love. Look again. The tickets are now diamonds. Anything is possible when your man smells like Old Spice and not a lady. I'm on a horse.
Hello, everybody. Look at yourself. Now back to me. Now back at yourself. Now back to me. Sadly, you are not a monster. But if you listen to Grover, you will know all about the word on, just as this monster does. Look down. Back up. Yep. Yeah. Where am I? Oh, I am on a boat. What is in your hand? Back at me. I have it. It is a clam with two tickets to that thing you love. On my nose? Anything is possible when you smell like a monster and know the word on. I am on a horse. Moo. Cow.
Hey guys, my name's Ian Mihawk. I've been working on my credit for about 2 years now, and thanks to a lot of early payments and on-time planning, I have a great credit score. A great credit rating proves that you can handle your money responsibly. I got a good credit score just from making my payments on time and making sure every month to pay off whatever I had on all my credit cards. Having a good credit score is like the chicken and the egg. You have to have good credit or else you're not going to get a loan, you're not going to get car payments, you're going to have high interest rates. But on the other hand, you can't have a good credit score until you've already had credit, and you can't get credit unless you've already had it for a while. I solved my chicken and the egg problem by getting a credit card when I went to school. I got there, I paid for my books on my credit card because I was going to buy them anyways, and then I paid them off the next month. Instant credit score. You want to look for a good credit card, one that doesn't have hidden fees, doesn't have things that you'll have to pay every year. You can't afford to do that. You need something with zero fees, zero liabilities, and a low APR rate. My friends have some problems with credit. Whether it be my one friend Ed.
I bought this 42-inch LCD TV on my credit card, and then I kind of got in a car accident, and I missed a few payments, but was already only making the minimum payments. So I'm probably gonna pay off this 42-inch LCD TV until I'm 40.
Or my one friend Laura.
I had a $5,000 loan for college that my parents got me, and I would have ended up having to pay $30,000 on eventually because they have such bad credit. I had to cancel the loan.
The best credit score is an 850, but most people don't achieve that. A good score is about 750 to 850. Below 750 to about 600 is still good, but you should do some things to improve your credit. Below 600, and you're talking bad cars, bad houses, maybe no house, maybe no car. Here's my credit score. I'm not at 850 yet, but I'm trying to be. Here are my five rules for getting a great credit score. Rule number one, you have to apply for the credit card first, or else you're never gonna get a good credit score. Rule number two, always spend within your means. Don't go out and buy a $1,000 TV like my friend Ed if you can't afford the TV in the first place. Three, pay your credit card off regularly. Don't keep a balance on your card because that'll ruin your credit score. Make sure to pay it off every month and have the money waiting in your bank account to pay the credit card off. Rule number four, don't open too many credit cards at once. Everywhere you go asks you to open a credit card. If you have a bunch of credit cards, you won't realize the balance you have on each one, and you'll end up in debt quicker than you can imagine. And rule number five, if you want a credit score like this, you have to pay off all your other bills on time. Car payments, house payments, make sure they're all paid on time, and paying off your credit cards will be a breeze. Getting a good credit score is like a game of hockey. Aim high, and if you don't get it the first time, just keep trying.
That's how we do it.
These waters, what would I pay to spend a day warm on the sand? Betcha on land, they understand that they don't reprimand their daughters. Bright young women, sick of swimming, ready to stand. And ready to know what the people know. Ask them my questions and get some answers.
I am a runner because I like to go fast. I like to do everything fast. The only problem is sometimes I read too fast and then I miss important details. Before my first big race, my coach handed me a note that said, "Good luck." The only problem is I read the note so fast that I didn't see that it actually said, "Good luck, and your shoes are untied." I did not win that race. The next race, I was in front of everyone when I saw a sign that said, "The finish line." Unfortunately, I rushed reading that sign too, and I didn't notice that it really said, "The finish line is that way." I did not win that race either. But this race today, I am definitely going to win. I followed all of Coach's instructions perfectly. Be at the track at 7 a.m., and that is exactly where I am. Funny, I don't see any other runners here. Maybe I should check those instructions again. Be at the track in China at 7 a.m. I missed the in China part. I was rushing again. China? Yeah, that's really far away. Well, I better get running.
Oh. Be good, I'll be back soon.
Pets Home Alone!
All right, fuzzballs, karaoke time!
It has the Hamster National Anthem! There's a Hamster National Anthem?
Oh, say, can you see by the rolling hamster ball? Hamsters are great, so let's all...
I don't know that word.
Wait, we can figure it out by using what we know. Are there any parts we know inside that big word?
I've seen C-E-L before.
Yeah, sell, like in celery.
Hamsters are great, so let's all celery.
That doesn't sound right. The N looks like the word eight.
And the middle part, B-R, sounds like brr, like when you're cold.
Cell, brr, eight.
Celebrate! Hamsters are great, so let's all celebrate.
Everyone raise some carrots to the best pets in the world, besides parents who are slightly better.
It's so beautiful.
Hello YouTube friends, so as you can see by my wet hair, today is a hair video. As you probably all know, David Beckham has released an underwear range for H&M, so that is the look I'm going to do. I was going to do this look anyway, because I think it's really, really cool, but loads and loads and loads of you have been requesting it, so this is what we're doing. If you haven't seen the images already, I can't show them to you, because the copyright gremlins will come and get me and take me away and eat my eyeballs, but I have done a blog post on it quite a while ago now, a couple of weeks ago, but there's a link below in the description box to my blog as always, so you can click on it and you can go and look at it. So this style is pretty much all about the blow dry. Putting the product in your hair is really, really simple, but you can't really achieve this look without blow drying it. It's got a really sharp parting and then sort of a really nice classic sort of swept over look. So to start with, I'm going to dry my hair. I have the nozzle on my hair dryer and I have a comb here. Now I have a little tip here. Because obviously you can't really dry your hair like your hairdresser does, because he's standing behind you, or she's standing behind you. So to do it yourself is, you know, quite tricky. My little tip is, firstly, find your parting, and the way I do that, get my comb, find a line. I'm going to be looking in my little thing here rather than the lens for a second so I can see. So you find where you want it to be and drag down like that, so then you've got a line and then you can go either side of it like this. Now at this point, if you're at the hairdresser's and you had your parting, your hairdresser will be running around everywhere doing all this stuff. We obviously don't have that luxury because we've only got two hands and our head is up here. Get your comb, hold it, say, on this side first, just where the parting is. So find your parting, hold it there. And then with the hairdryer, you can dry sort of across that way without blowing this bit all over the shop. So when you've done that bit, you can swap and hold your comb above and dry downwards like that. So when you're giving yourself a parting, bear in mind that you've just done it with hot air blowing everywhere, so it's not going to look perfect yet. But as you can see, it's on its way. We're then going to dry our fringe sort of upwards and to one side. And now for my styling product. This is by Hairbond, and it's called Designer. This is a hair cream, so it's obviously creamy in texture. It gives a fair amount of hold, but without looking like too much in your hair. It gives a sort of shine to your hair as well, but not a really obvious shine. It's nice and sort of natural, it just catches the light nicely. Just smear it in your hands like this. Use your fingertips like this to rake it backwards. Don't put your whole hand in, because you're going to get just a blob of it in the front. So we're just raking it all backwards like this, with your fingertips, and then the sides as well. So when you've got it roughly how you want it, this is the point where you can really focus on the parting. So get a little bit, not much, because you will saturate your hair. So a tiny bit like this, just on your fingertips here, and just really focus on that parting area. Once you've sorted the parting out and got a nice crisp line, you can use your comb if you want to. With whatever's left on your hands, you can sort of run it through and start raking the front backwards. You could use a comb here, and sort of start raking it back into one side. But I quite like to just use my fingers, and that's the look that David Beckham's gone for. But there you go, that's the finished look. Obviously David Beckham wears it infinitely better than I do, just because he's David Beckham. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you very soon. Goodbye. It's exfoliant. Now it has 10%, yes, 10% glycolic acid. Glycolic acid sounds awful. It sounds like your face is gonna melt off and then your eyeballs will roll out.
You're expected to take certain duties on board. The future is littered with prizes, and though I'm the main addressee, the point that I must emphasize is...
Please leave a message and your number, and we'll call you back as soon as possible.
Hello, Dr. Murphy. Hey, this is Jim Bob. Hey, we've got, Johanna broke out with chickenpox a couple weeks ago, and now we have 11 more broke out. Josie's going to be coming home next week, and hopefully we'll get this taken care of. But anyway, well, God bless you guys. Have a good day. Give me a call back when you get time.
About the time that Josie was scheduled to be released from the hospital, our Johanna came down with chickenpox, and we knew that that meant that any of the others that were around her that hadn't had them yet would probably be getting them too. And so that's when we made the decision we would just stay in Little Rock a little longer.
Josie looking big?
Dad and the kiddos were on their way home from a road trip, and they stopped at Little Rock to say hi through the glass door. Hi. For the first 2 years of her life, Miss Josie is kind of going to live in a little bubble.
Nice.